Hi, my name is Félix Matos Rodríguez, and I am the Chancellor of the City University of New York. People who know me call me Felo, and this is my new conversation space on CUNY TV, Café con Felo. Bienvenidos a Café con Felo. In studios with us today, Beatriz de la Torre, Chief Philanthropy Officer at Trinity Church Wall Street. Since its founding more than 300 years ago, in 1697, Trinity Church has transformed into a dynamic Episcopal parish, deeply involved in grant-making efforts targeting housing and homelessness, racial justice, and leadership development. I hope our conversation today will bring our viewers insights into the recent endeavors of Trinity Church in supporting housing for vulnerable CUNY students, as well as a number of other efforts aimed at addressing the city's housing and homelessness challenges. Ms. De La Torre has a distinguished career spanning both city government and the nonprofit sector. She's a tireless advocate for combating racial injustice and homelessness here in New York, spearheading impact investment initiatives aimed at increasing the availability of low-income, affordable housing. Her leadership has earned the reputation of being not only a grant maker, but a change maker. Within the CUNY community, we're especially fortunate to have Ms. De La Torre's vision among the board of directors of the CUNY School of Professional Studies Foundation since 2022. I'm looking forward to our conversation today, Bea, but the first question here at Café con Felo is, do you drink coffee and how many cups you take a day?
First of all, thank you so much for having me. I absolutely drink coffee, maybe a little too much. I might have had 5 cups already today, but that's it. I cut it off at 3 p.m.
Is it black or?
Black with a little bit of milk, no sugar. I like it bitter.
We're delighted to have you here. Thank you for making time. I think we should begin by letting our viewers have a little bit of a sense of the history of Trinity Church Wall Street, its founding, its mission, and its impact in New York City.
Absolutely. So Trinity Church is many things, but first and foremost, we're an Episcopal parish located in Lower Manhattan. As you said earlier, we've been around for quite some time, over 325 years. And as an Episcopal church located in Lower Manhattan, we serve the communities of first New York City, and then second, the Episcopal Church and the Anglican Communion more globally. So we have a very thriving congregation of over 1,600 members who also really channel some big social causes that very much tie to the philanthropic work that I get the pleasure to work on. And on top of that, we have a robust music program. We also have a very famous cemetery where somebody very famous that you might know, Alexander Hamilton and his wife, or buried at. And we also do a lot of programming outside of our building. I can tell you that today we served over 300 people that needed food assistance to come through. Many of them or most recent New Yorkers or migrants that have been coming into the city. We also offer English as a second language classes for them and many other programming to address the needs of New Yorkers. On top of that, we have a very robust philanthropic portfolio, and I will give you a little bit of background and history of why we have that, because it is unique for a church to have such a robust philanthropic portfolio. So in 1705, Queen Anne granted 215 acres to a very small parish called Trinity Church in Lower Manhattan, and that basically was a big part of this land gift has created this very significant endowment for us. So through that, we're able to do a lot of things that are completely mission aligned, again, in supporting the needs of our communities as I describe them. And out of that comes the philanthropic funding that I have the pleasure of leading. So to give you a little bit of a sense, last year we provided grants to over 200 organizations for a total of $38 million. And I, again, could not be more blessed to be able to do this work and have such a great team. And within that, there's two specific portfolios in New York City that we focus on. So one we call racial justice, and that portfolio is really focused on healthy minds and safe communities. We do a lot of funding around criminal justice reform and a lot of funding around mental health and really moving into the youth space as well. And then the other portfolio is housing and homelessness, which recognizes that New York City has been in a homelessness crisis for way too long. And that portfolio focuses on providing assistance for people that find themselves to be housing insecure or homeless, but also a lot of prevention efforts to make sure that people do not get to that point. So that was the portfolio that I used to lead before stepping into this chief philanthropic role that I am in currently.
And for our viewers too, we're very fortunate to be among the 200 organizations that receive support, and we're going to be talking about that in a second. But thank you for that context. I think that many New Yorkers do not know. I mean, they might know the church, they might know the Hamilton story, but they don't know the impact that the church and the philanthropic arm has had. Let me now switch back now to your career. And not a lot of people, I think, go to college thinking they're going to be in philanthropy. You've been able to transition there, in part of because of your track record in the work of, you know, housing insecurity and homelessness and housing in general. Mm-hmm. Can you give us a little bit of sense of, A, how does, you know, Bea de la Torre decide that housing is going to be one of her main topics of interest, and how that work that you've done in government, in nonprofits, leads you and prepares you to this for this role?
So I will start by saying first that I am from the island of Puerto Rico. I'm very proud and will be Boricua forever.
We love that island, yes.
We do love that island, too much sometimes. but I always start there because I think what's driven me to do mission-aligned work is that I come from our island, right? Puerto Rico is a beautiful place, and it has so many wonderful, positive things, but it also has a lot of disparities as it relates to socioeconomic status and a lot of injustices. So from a very early age, I was taught that there is a sense of fairness, and there are some things that are very unfair, and we're very lucky in many ways and count your blessings, but for the things where you can actually help and make a difference, you should fight for it. That was very much taught by my mom, who's still alive and still very much lives by that. So I grew up in Puerto Rico, came to the mainland for college, and then moved to New York right after, and I worked at corporate jobs. I worked for American Express. For a while, I had worked for Procter & Gamble and such. And I would walk around New York City and would always say, like, what I love about New York City is all these neighborhoods. New York City is a city of neighborhoods, right? And that led me to think, you know what? I want to go into urban planning. I think that would be the right thing for me. So I went to get my master's degree in urban planning and came to New York and kind of stumbled upon housing, I will say. I will tell you, I worked for the Lower Manhattan Development Corporation. Which was established after 9/11 to rebuild Lower Manhattan. And there I had, as it happens often, just the best boss who happened to be going into a housing job. So she said, when you graduate from grad school, will you come and work in the housing agency with me? And I was like, I don't know about housing. I wanna do all these other things. But because she was a great boss, I followed her. And so I worked for the Department of Housing Preservation and Development for the city of New York. It was one of those jobs where I started and I said to myself, I'm gonna be here for a year or two, I'll learn a few things and then I'll move on. Almost a decade later, after realizing that housing truly is the core of stability, I decided this has been fantastic. I gained so much experience, and it was very focused on the real estate piece. It was very focused on where do you develop affordable housing in New York City, taking the process through the public land review, and then talking to communities about how the housing was gonna help them. But after that, I realized I need to dig into this deeper beyond the real estate. And I moved into philanthropy. I started my career at the Robin Hood Foundation. And what was fascinating, Felo, is that after working in the housing field for 10 years, moving into the philanthropic world is when I actually started learning about homelessness. So it just tells you so much about how siloed things are, that when you're in real estate mode, you're like, production of housing, this is what I'm focused on. But I really hadn't thought about all the other things that were happening in the ecosystem, and particularly those that were not even getting into the housing, that were in the shelters, and like why they ended up there. So I ended up at the Robin Hood Foundation for about 5 years, managing that portfolio. And then this incredible opportunity at Trinity Church Wall Street came up, where I had the ability to build the portfolio from scratch, basically saying to myself, if I have $10 million, which was the annual budget for that portfolio, like, where can Trinity Church make a difference? Where can we really move the needle? And it's been one of the most fulfilling things in my career. And I feel so incredibly blessed to be able to do this work.
I find it interesting that you said that you began in this space also talking about sort of real estate and how to allocate things, and now you're an institution that has been able to sort of mobilize real estate for the public good mm-hmm. in terms of the endowment and that work. So let's talk a little bit about some of the work that you get to do and you were doing before you became the head of the chief of philanthropy. Give us a sense a little bit of your work with, with BMCC, with CUNY, mm-hmm. In the space of sort of higher education and housing insecurity. We're fortunate to have the scholars program, and can you give us a sense as to maybe why you decided that those kinds of programs were impactful and your sense of how they can grow and how can they scale?
So let me start by saying that those are some of my proudest grants, and I'm really not saying that because I'm here. I truly, truly mean it, and I'll get to that in a little bit, but let me...
We'll delete that when your other funders listen to the show.
Exactly. But I will say in the same context I was talking about being in the real estate world and not learning about homelessness, uh-huh. I will also say that after spending a lot of time thinking about homelessness, it wasn't until 2019 when I read a report issued that talked about the needs of CUNY students that I realized the extremely high percentage of CUNY students that were facing homelessness and then housing insecurity and food insecurity as well. This was a report that it was issued by the Hope Center.
Yep. And Nick Frydenberg also and his colleagues.
Exactly, yep. Exactly. And it truly opened my eyes. And again, this was after spending almost a decade thinking about homelessness and all the other different populations, which included certainly youth, survivors of domestic violence, many other populations, but I never thought, students. Are included in that. So, all too well, 14% of students had documented homelessness the year prior, and a much higher percentage had documented housing instability.
Insecurity. Yep.
Insecurity, exactly, and then food insecurity as well. So that coincided with the Neighborhood Coalition for Shelter, also known as NCS, coming to talk to us for funding and saying, this is an issue we want to focus on. This is a wonderful not-for-profit that has a long track record, specifically understanding the needs of homeless youth.
Yep.
So it kind of all came together for me in 2019, where I said, we got to do something about this. This is a huge issue. It's almost like an invisible problem. It's not invisible, it's huge, but we don't talk about it. I go to conferences all the time. Why aren't we all outraged about this? So for NCS in particular, what we did, we started with a planning grant, $50,000 planning grant to basically say, go after this issue, see what you could do. At that point, they had big plans of coming up with a real estate solution, which in my mind, I always said to myself, that's of course what we need. That's gonna be hard to figure out, but let's give you a planning grant. Let's see how that could work out. And then of course, since then, they were able to figure it out and have launched a really wonderful program, the NCS Scholars Program, which we then have continued to support, which right now is in Long Island City. They have a building, they're housing over 30 students.
You and I were able to be there at the opening and had the phenomenal student from Edgar Evers talk about her experience and how much of a change it made in her life. So thank you for that investment.
Yes, which is incredible. And I think about this student, her name is Isabella, and I think about her a lot and the stories that she shared. Behind every one of these numbers, there's one of these heartbreaking stories, and giving them the opportunity to have the ability to really focus on their studies is just such an important thing, truly. So we made that investment, and then the other one that you referenced, Felo, is the one that we made to the Borough of Manhattan Community College, also known as BMCC, which is right in our neighborhood, right in our backyard, very close to Trinity. And we had a long-standing partnership already with BMCC. We had been supporting a program called Project Impact, which helps students that have been touched by the criminal justice system, either themselves personally or their family members, and really helping assist their needs. And what we kept hearing over and over is they're coming saying they need housing. So the question was, well, what can we do? So at that point, we were very fortunate to be able to make a $2 million grant to be able to house up to 40 students in a beautiful building in Harlem for up to 3 years. Yes. And the idea is, these are the students that are really trying to make it work. Let's make sure the housing insecurity is not what gets in the way of them completing their studies. So we are just so thrilled to be able to partner with you and be able to provide a chance for these students to finish their...
And we're deeply appreciative, and we know that in many cases it is not the academic side that derails the students, is the things in their daily life, like housing, like food, like transportation, that get in the way and prevent them from really achieving their full potential and moving forward. So the housing issue is New York City's sort of like big issue, so that it connects with higher ed should not surprise anyone. And that is great to have thought partners. I also want to thank you for your leadership in convening funders a couple of months ago, that we had that convening to think about the issue sort of writ large and to find solutions and partners, which sort of leads me, I mentioned in the intro that people refer to you as someone who's not a grant maker but a change maker, right? And I always know that you're really good about having a call to action and making sure that people always use every opportunity to think deep and make change. To the viewers out there, what would be that call today for them?
So the call is that government needs to step up. We really need our city and our state to step up to really recognize the needs of these students. I really think of CUNY as the economic engine of New York City. So for me, an investment in CUNY is an investment in New York City, and we all want our city to flourish, yep, right? But we really need a large-scale solution to this. We have, you know, as I said, been fortunate enough to assist, you know, it's going to be, I don't know, close to 100 students.
And
I do truly believe in the trickle-down effect. Like, those 100 students are going to help others, and there's going to be a magnifying effect. But it's a drop in the bucket in comparison to the number of students that need the assistance. So in a way, I'm hoping that our investment has helped put the spotlight on the challenges, brings other funders along, but really what we need is government to step up.
I mean, clearly at scale, the only one that can really do that at scale. I mean, connected also with addressing housing issues writ large in the city. I mean, if we do that, if we do a better job at that citywide, the angle that affects students would also be beneficial. I think it's important that people recognize that, and I think it's particularly important for a place like CUNY that is a commuter school. The reason why we don't think much about this, because we think about the traditional college student with a dorm, and that is actually not the majority of the students in this country, community college, commuter students. So I think what we're learning working with you and with some others is really, really, really important. Anything else that you have learned in working with either higher ed or with this space that you want to share?
Well, just to go back to the idea of CUNY being the economic mobility engine, I just think this is a proven thing, right? Mm-hmm. Like the way to, for a low income household or somebody to be able to truly move in terms of their economic mobility is to really get their education. So again, it's just a really big investment. Plus on the workforce side, like this is the workforce of New York City, right? So we really need to focus on that piece. The last thing I wanted to also mention is, because of my work with the SBS Foundation Board,
yes,
I've been able to be exposed on how important emergency grants are, that sometimes truly it's a matter of a $500 help to stabilize somebody. And I think that is so important. It's something that I hope that we are able to do, us as a foundation. But I also think the regular New Yorkers that can should also be thinking about how they can contribute to help.
Because that doesn't require a huge amount of money to make a great difference. And you get the satisfaction of knowing that you help a student with a very, very specific issue, with a very specific problem. And that's the one thing that allows them to graduate, get that diploma, get that job, be able to do advance economically for them and for their families too, because some of those students also are parents, right?
Correct.
So you're having a two-generation effect when you help those students move forward. So thank you for that. And it was perfect that you mentioned the students from the School of Professional Studies, because we're going to be hearing from them soon. So we're going to have to take a quick break. But when we come back, we'll take questions from students from the CUNY School of Professional Studies. Stay tuned. Welcome back. You are watching Café con Felo. My guest today is Beatriz de la Torre, Chief Philanthropy Officer at Trinity Church Wall Street, an advocate for affordable student housing, and promoter of academic success, among many other things. For our student questions section of the program, we went to the CUNY School of Professional Studies. Let's hear what the students have to ask. And the first question, I think, comes from Rachel.
Hello, my name is Rachel Castillo, and I am an alumni of CUNY SPS, as well as the program manager for CUNY's Intergenerational Change Initiative. Do you have examples of successful intergenerational policy making in your work here in New York City? Thanks.
Intergenerational, you must have in that portfolio of grants worked in that area.
Absolutely, and thank you so much, Rachel, for that question. So intergenerational policies on the housing space are something that's evolving. And actually, there's some very interesting intergenerational housing models right now that we're looking at, where there is a recognition that maybe there is something to be said for, you know, youth, young adults that could be living in the same building as older adults, where they can help each other out and also create some sort of mentorship connection there. So there's a lot there. And then, of course, as it relates to peer mentoring as well, that's a really big space, and mentorship. So there's many, many examples that we can give that are important. And I do think in the housing space, it's an area that predominantly we're going to be seeing a lot more in the future years.
I think that theme of mentoring was a key theme in your career.
Yes.
We all need mentors. So I thank you for sharing that. I think we have a question coming up now from Leonard.
Hello, Beatrice. My name is Leonard Blades, and I am a current student here at CUNY SBS in the Master's Program for Disability Studies. My question for you today is, in your opinion, what role do you think accessibility will play in the future of New York City housing?
Before you go to Leonard's question, let me mention that he's been one of our key CUNY leaders for years in a great group that's called the CUNY Students with Disabilities, that they're great advocates within the university and outside in, you know, addressing issues of funding and programming for students with disabilities. And Leonard has been a key leader. So in that portfolio of racial justice and that, the issue of accessibility and disabilities.
Yeah. And first of all, congratulations to Leonard for lending his voice. Yeah. And because it is so important for the young adults to be leaders here and to be voicing what they think is important. So kudos to you, Leonard, and keep doing it. It's such a key question, the issue of accessibility on various levels. And I will talk maybe a little bit in the context of housing. Mm-hmm. It is something that I will say is not discussed enough, even though there are mandated requirements from the federal government, certainly for any new construction projects, that there's a specific percentage of units that's set aside. But it's not enough, again, for the need. So I think there's a lot to learn there. There's a lot to continue to advocate for. And as it relates to retrofitting spaces, that's a big piece of the equation that still needs to be figured out. I will quickly note, Trinity Church real estate tends to be more a commercial portfolio, but we do have one building. It happens to be one residential building. It happens to be a senior building. Okay. And we just went through a whole round of renovations in order to make it more physically accessible for people, and also for hearing impairment and visual impairment. And the results are so beautiful. We even included a walking track where if you have either a wheelchair or a walker, you can go in order to exercise. So I'm very proud of that work, but I think it's a great question, Leonard, and I really wanna encourage you to continue to advocate for what's needed.
It's important, and also when you talk about funding, it's also very expensive. I mean, the retrofitting, I mean, something that we have to do in our campuses that have some older buildings where, you know, there was no ADA legislation, and you know, it's important to do it, but it's also very, very expensive to do that. So additional funding always comes in handy. Mm-hmm. We have one last question from LaTroya.
Hi, Beatrice. I am Latroya Lavelle. I am a CUNY School of Professional Studies alumni and the current Director of Youth Research with Why Vote, Next Gen Politics. And my question for you today is, do you feel like there's any room for collaboration with the city and youth-serving nonprofits to develop affordable, supportive housing for young adults in New York City?
Talk about a question right down your alley of expertise, and I know you've also written op-eds, and this is really your area. So what will you say to Latroya?
Well, first of all, Latroya, thank you for that question. And it's so great to see all the CUNY SPS
yes.
current students and alums. So thank you all so much for all your great questions. So as it relates to supportive housing for youth, the need is enormous, and there are not close to as many units to fulfill the needs, right? So there's even a calculation overall for supportive housing that for every 10 people that need a supportive housing unit, there's only one that exists for them. And when it relates to youth, I bet you the ratio is even higher. But there are some really great models, and there's some great organizations, actually Neighborhood Coalition for Shelter and CS being one of them, that are doing some really interesting things, as are others like The Door, which is also located in Lower Manhattan. And I think what we need is more advocacy, really, to really push our elected officials, to really push our government to say this is a resource that's needed. And I know it's expensive, but there are ways to be creative with the sources of funding so that we can create a lot more housing for this population.
Well, I mean, and you mentioned the issue of being expensive, right? But the expense that you incur when the support is not there for that youth or those is gonna be times magnified. So it's important to do the investments early on so that you're not investing that money in things that are remediative or punitive down the line, and nobody wins when that happens. But thank you again. I'm very happy that you got the questions from the students who benefit from the great work that you and other members of the School of Professional Studies Foundation get to do. And I want to thank you for that service, because I know that you're a very busy woman and with your family and all your commitments. So thank you for doing that. And that is a perfect segue. It's the end. So I want to thank you, Beatriz de la Torre, Bea, for joining us on the show today, for being such an incredible partner, for being committed to philanthropy, and for your notable contributions to advancing affordable housing, racial justice, and to being a great change and thought partner. And thank you on behalf of all the CUNY students for all that your colleagues at Trinity Church and you do. To the audience out there, thank you for watching. Please tune in for Café con Felo on weekends, on Friday, Saturday, and Sunday at 8 p.m. on CUNY TV. Nos vemos. Saludos.